afternoon.
Woken a couple of you up.
Welcome to Raising St. Stephen's Episcopal Church, and welcome to this Taylor Memorial Concert, the first we've been able to have in our worship space with an audience in quite some time. Thank you for being here. I want to also thank you for following all our COVID safety protocols. We appreciate it, and so does our bishop. So thank you very much for that. You're in for a real treat this afternoon. This is the dedicatory concert for our new antiphonal organ, which you might have seen on our west wall. If you haven't, I encourage you to take a look. It's beautiful. We were able to have this beautiful instrument thanks to... Thanks to our own Connie Eggers. Connie has blessed the congregation with this beautiful instrument in memory of her dear husband, Arthur, and also in honor of her good friend, Father Matthew Corkin, who right now is struggling with very intense health issues. And so keep him in your prayers. But it is a blessing. It's a blessing that this congregation will continue to benefit from for many years to come. And so thank you, Connie. Thank you for your generosity. And before I introduce our tremendously talented organist choir master, who is going to introduce our superb organist today, I would like to say a prayer for this new instrument. If you would join me, the Lord be with you. Let us pray. O Lord, before whose throne trumpets sound, and saints and angels sing the songs of Moses and the Lamb, accept this antiphonal organ for the worship of your temple, that with the voice of music we may proclaim your praise and tell it abroad through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. It's now my great privilege to introduce our very talented organist choir master, Mr. Simon Jacobs.
Well, it's very gracious of Father Jeremiah to describe me as talented. I think you're going to hear real talent today with fabulous David Briggs. Now, the antiphonal, as a gift of Connie Eggers, really does enhance the sound of the organ here, especially in worship. You'll hear it at the back. Those of you closer to the back will hear it even more, but you'll find it's a sort of surround sound today. It's wonderful. And before that was there was nothing. Just sort of white walls, and I think it really complements also the fabric of the church. The wood is white, and it was matched to the pews, as if it has always been there, and that was the intention. So it's a wonderful part of the instrument, thanks again to Connie, of course. And just a few housekeeping things. We do request that you keep your masks on at all times in here, and now's the time to check your phones. Silent, please, or off. Don't want more going off. Bathrooms, restrooms, are down the corridor and to the left, if you should need them. It is an honour and a privilege to have David Briggs here today, and we go back a long way. David was my mentor when I was 6 or 7 years old. I used to go to the cathedral in Truro, Cornwall, and hear him play. And really, you know, almost entirely responsible for me taking up the organ and following this career path. And when I was 7, I auditioned for the cathedral choir. David was auditioning me, and I got in. So it's so wonderful to have an old friend and mentor here. David, you can read about in your program, very extensive biography. He's one of the world's premier concert organists now, and does over 50 concerts per year, traveling everywhere all over the world. So you're in for a treat today, and you don't want to hear me speak anymore. One more thing. When you leave, try to go that way. David's got some CDs for sale, and DVDs. Really want to pick one of them up. So without further ado, I'd love to welcome Mr. David Briggs.
you, ladies and gentlemen. It's just so amazing to be performing to real people again after this extraordinary time we've had, which I lost something like 75 concerts. But one of the, I suppose, the silver linings of the pandemic for me is that I had lots of time to practice, lots of time to compose, and also 95% of these concerts have been postponed into next year and into 2023, so I'm kind of busier than ever. But it's just to be playing, I think it was Benjamin Britten who spoke about the equilateral triangle of composer, performer, and audience. And you take one of those ingredients away, and it falls apart. And just to have that sort of triumvirate again has been a marvelous thing. Congratulations on this fabulous new Antiphonal organ. It sounds fantastic. It looks as though it's always been there, and it really is a splendid thing. We'll be here, God willing, for many hundreds of years to come. Jack Bethards is a friend of mine, the managing director of Schoenstein, and I mean, I can really assure you that this is the equivalent of buying a new Mercedes or a new Audi A8. It's, you know, mechanically and artistically of a very, very high level. And the kind of miraculous thing is that it blends with the Velty organ so perfectly. So, as Simon just said, I was his choir master. I first met Simon when he was 7 years old, and I can tell you that in the last 30 years, he really hasn't changed at all. Exactly the same personality, the same great musicality, the same insight, the same extremely British sense of humour. And I would like to just thank Simon for the invitation to come here, and also to have the experience of accompanying the beautiful choir of Grace and St. Stephen's. In my present incarnation, I mean, I was a cathedral organist in the UK for 20 plus years. Of course, every day I would be accompanying choirs. Now I'm so busy doing my razzle-dazzle concerts, it's very rare that I get to accompany a good choir. And just to sit underneath this choir, seeing I was glad by Parry this morning, was a very, very memorable experience for me, and I'm very grateful for it. It reminds me of when we went on tour with the Truro Cathedral Choir. I think Simon was probably part of that tour as a chorister. We sang the Parry I Was Glad in the cathedral in Camberg, in Brittany, and the choir was, this was a sold-out concert, the choir was sitting at the front on the steps. The organ, as in so many cases in France, the big organ is at the back. About, you know, it's probably double the length of this church, if not more. And so, inevitably, with the speed of sound, it takes, there's a big time lag. But Henry Doughty, the assistant organist, did a marvelous job, and we got it together. And after this was the last piece of the concert, and the audience started applauding very, very loudly. It was amazing. Because in France, really, they have this great organ tradition, but the choral tradition is not so much to write home about, I suppose. So they heard this choir of boys and men belting it out, and Parry I Was Glad, and the place exploded with applause afterwards. And I was conducting, and at the end, I did this to encourage the audience to applaud Henry, who was the assistant organist at the other end of the cathedral, playing via headphones. And so I did this, and the whole audience stood up. It was a great way to achieve a standing ovation. But anyway, there it is. So I've chosen a selection of, well, I would say, some of my very, very most favorite pieces to perform this afternoon, and explicitly to show off the amazing symphonic colors of this organ. You know, when this organ was built in 1928 in New York by Velty, the tradition was, it was before the sort of early music revival, the Baroque revival, and organists all the time were playing transcriptions of organ, of orchestral works. And I think it's very nice that now in the 21st century, that the pendulum has sort of come back more into the middle. People, of course, are playing with more historically informed fingering and touch and so on, but also playing for the general music-loving public, and playing orchestral music, which I think suits this organ so beautifully. So the first piece, Franz Schmidt, you probably won't have heard of Franz Schmidt, but he was from Vienna. He was the principal cello of the Vienna Opera Orchestra under Gustav Mahler in the 1890s and the early 1900s. And Mahler and Franz Schmidt were very great friends. Schmidt wrote a number of very fine organ pieces. And this is something, again, to come out of the pandemic. I just heard this D major, Berlin Fugue, on YouTube, played by the organist of Cologne Cathedral, and completely fell in love with it straight away. I listened to it about five times. It's an amazing piece, so triumphant, and I think very appropriate for this occasion today. You can sort of visualize maybe Easter morning with huge procession and many priests and choir, lots and lots of incense, and the cathedral full of people. It's that kind of very inspiring and sort of awesome, in the true meaning of the word, music. So I hope you'll enjoy the D major Hallelujah Prelude and Fugue. It starts pretty much on the tutti, so it's a bit like a Boeing 737-800 lining up at the end of COS runway 28. And you know that time, that experience when they put the full power on and hold the aircraft on the brakes and then release the brakes, and then you're aware of the sensation of the power. It's that kind of music. It's pretty amazing. Second piece I'd like to perform for you is one of the pieces that's really very close to my own heart, 1819, the César Franck Second Chorale. César Franck, the organist of Sainte-Clotilde in Paris, and my teacher, Jean Monglet, with whom I studied in 84 and 85, he was also the organist of Sainte-Clotilde, and I studied this piece with Jean Monglet in 1985. Longley had been a pupil at the Institut des Jeunes Aveugles, the young blind school in Paris. He was a pupil of Albert Maillot, who was a Belgian organist, who himself was a pupil of Franck, which means that Jean Longley, my teacher, was a second generation Franck pupil, which I guess, ironically, means that I'm a third generation Franck pupil. But he wrote, César Franck wrote this music in the year of his death, 1890. It's like a sort of testament, really, a last will and testament. It's the emotional heart of Franck, constructed like a passacaglia. So you'll hear the theme being played many times and sort of in all sorts of different guises. It's very romantic, very passionate, full of glorious melody, and even more glorious harmony. César Franck died sort of prematurely, really, in 1890 of the results from a motor accident. He had a collision with a tram. And that just, he was checking his Facebook on his cell phone. And it just proves when you do cross the road, don't be looking at your phone, otherwise you'll end up like César Franck. A pupil of César Franck, Louis Vienne, was the organist of Notre Dame in Paris, appointed in 1900, died there on the 2nd of June 1937, when he passed away in the middle of the 1750th recital that he gave in the cathedral. And he always said that that's how he wanted to pass away, at the organ of Notre Dame, and sure enough he did. This symphony, it's from 1904, the Second Symphony. It's like, you know, if you go to a fine restaurant and they bring a sorbet in the middle, you have a couple of courses, a little bit of wine, and then they bring a palate cleanser. This is what this is in this program. It's like Moët Chandon champagne, very effervescent, very bubbly, quite cold and sparkling. And I've registered it, the stops that I've chosen, you'll be able to hear a sort of antiphonal effect between back and front. So I hope you'll enjoy that sort of surround sound. Maurice Ravel, very sadly, never wrote a single note of music for the organ. I don't really know why, because of course an absolutely sublime composer for the piano, and even more so for the orchestra, but not a single piece of organ music. The Mother Goose Suite originally was written in 1909 as a piano duet. It was a commission from a family who had two young girls. Ravel adored children and nursery rhymes. He was never married, never had children of his own. But the Mother Goose Suite is just a sublime piece, very impressionistic, very colourful. Originally for piano duet, and Ravel orchestrated it some years later. And I hope that he would enjoy hearing this composition on an organ like this, where, you know, the intention is not to make it sound like the orchestra, but the truth of the matter is that there is as much colour on an organ like this, if not more, than the orchestra has. And of course, it's all controlled by one person. Now, with the advent of computers, it's possible to change all the sonorities very, very quickly at the touch of a button. So you'll hear all sorts of things: harps, chimes, flutes, contrabassoons, and it's amazing music. The last movement, Le Jardin Féerique, the Enchanted Garden, is, I think, is one of the most sublime and perfect pieces of music to come out of the beginning of the 20th century, and makes a ravishingly beautiful organ piece. Now, is there anybody here from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania? Fantastic. Well, I was playing a concert in Pittsburgh about 4 years ago, and came to the end of the concert. This guy comes up to me and says, pardon my US accent, I've lived in the US for 18 years, and very proudly got my US citizenship in 2012, but I've sort of kept my British accent. Although I do find myself sometimes saying British as opposed to British, like the Queen or the BBC would pronounce. Then this guy from Pittsburgh comes up and says, Dr. Briggs, it's such an honor to meet you after all these years. Thank you very much, sir. It's very nice to meet you as well. Hope you enjoy the concert. Would you mind if you sign one of my CDs? Of course, sir, this would be a pleasure. Plastic bag, out comes CD number one. Elvis Presley. So I'm thinking, hold on 1 minute. Would you like me to sign this David Briggs or Elvis Presley? Oh, David Briggs, of course. It's such an honor to meet you after all these years. Well, thank you very much. So here's me feeling like a complete Wally, signing the back of this CD, David Briggs. Out comes CD number two. Elvis Presley, white jacket, you know, the pink Chevrolet or the guitar and so on. I merrily sign David Briggs. This guy says to me, gee, you've really changed your style in the last 20 years. I said, well, if you say so, I really don't know. CD number three comes out, you guessed it, Elvis Presley. I notice on the third CD, on the back of the sleeve, that Elvis in the 1970s had a keyboard player called David Briggs. He thought I was that David Briggs, and did I have the humility to tell him that I wasn't? I just said, well, actually, I'm very happy to sign this, and I had lunch with the King only last week, and he's in very good health. That's a long way around to say that in your program, there's on the back page, I think it is, there is, I just started doing this, many of us now, of course, have these great cell phones, there's a QR code. If you take a photograph of that QR code, you'll get a little bar on the top of your phone, which you then you have to press, and you can have a, see a lot of details about the CDs that are available afterwards. And I commend that those to you very warmly. Now, if the QR code works as it should, it's all good. But if you get the Chinese restaurant half a mile down the road towards downtown, then I apologize, but that's a nice restaurant too. So without further ado, ladies and gentlemen, we're ready for takeoff. Make sure that your seats are in the upright position and you're firmly belted in. And there may be a little bit of turbulence. My goodness, yesterday coming into Colorado Springs on the approach, whoa! I used to be a pilot for about 7 years in my 30s, and this was a very expertly flown crosswind landing. I guess we're so near to the mountains here. I should say, and I meant to tell you this at the beginning, this is my first trip to your very beautiful state, and I'm so excited and happy and thrilled to be in Colorado for the first time. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.